Middle Eastern Studies at Northwestern University in Qatar. At the committee and the university at large, the media school, we felt compelled to organize this panel, among other things that we are planning to have, in order to explore the recent war in Palestine from a media perspective. As everybody else, we have watched the unfolding latest Israeli war on Palestine that started in Jerusalem, Hayy Sheikh Jarrah, and then expanded to almost everywhere in Palestine between the River Jordan and the Mediterranean, though in different manifestations. We have witnessed the killing of hundreds of civilians, with the vast majority in the Gaza Strip, where children and families were bombarded by Israeli warplanes, and the destruction of buildings and infrastructure, and in fact, the total mayhem that was inflicted on the Palestinians in only 11 days. We have also watched the use and exploitation of the media by powerful corporations and the platforms that mostly and shamelessly, in fact, sided by the colonial occupier. This positioning of the mainstream Western media specifically is not new. It's a fact that we have lived with for more than a century now in the case of Palestine. In other cases, and over maybe centuries, two, three centuries, integral to the colonial enterprise has been the control of the narrative and the control of the media, of course. Now, back to Palestine, the Palestinian case, we have the Zionist, Israeli, and Western media. All of them have been controlling the narrative and maybe succeeded even in creating what could be described as the colonial ministry of truth, to borrow George Orwell's famous notion, ministry of truth. This basically means for me to impose on everyone a collection of distorted facts, misinformation, lies, fabrications that would become over time that truth that the mainstream media would only narrate and the people would believe in as the truth. I think we all think that academics, public intellectuals, and fair-minded media people have the responsibility to fight such control and hegemonic media and to decolonize both the academia and the media. This fight is part and parcel of a wider struggle of decolonization culturally and politically that we should identify ourselves with at the very global level. Now, within this understanding, we meet together this evening for this event. And we are very pleased to host a very strong line of speakers. Each of them has been engaged in the media, either as an academic or researcher or practitioner. Each of them has contributed and is still contributing on a daily basis to the noble fight of free media, free speech, justice, and the dismantling of the colonial ministry of truth. We have today with us Helga Tawil-Souri, Marc Owens, Dima Khatib, and Kareem Darwish. I will not introduce the very impressive biographies of all of them now, but we'll do so for each just before the individual interventions. Each of our speakers will have 10 minutes for their contribution, and after that, we will open up for questions and answers. We will start with Dr. Helga Tawil-Souri. Helga, let me introduce you. Helga is Associate Professor in the Department of Media, Culture, and Communication and the Department of Middle Eastern Studies at the New York University. Helga works on issues to do with technology, media, culture, territory, and politics, with a particular focus on the Middle East and especially Palestine hyphen Israel. She has researched and written on Arab media, Palestinian cinema, television, video games, and popular culture. Also on telecommunications and internet infrastructure and development in Palestine. She writes Palestinian territories. I hate this term, so I say Palestine. As well as on cultural territorial politics in Palestine, analyzing even checkpoints as cultural and economic spaces and identifiers. I can go on and on, but I think I will stop here in the biography and move to Helga. Helga will focus on the notion of digital occupation from an infrastructure perspective. So we start from the broader context, the infrastructure of digital occupation, and then we start somehow narrowing down the discussion with our speakers one after another. So Helga, I think now the mic and screen yours, so go, you can go ahead.
Great, thank you so much. Thank you, Khaled, thank you, Virginia, thank you, Ilham, thank you everybody for being here, as well as my fellow co-panelists. I wish we were together, but nonetheless, I'm pleased to be virtually with you. So as Khaled mentioned, most of my research and my interest has been on the sort of state of Palestinian media, as well as telecommunications, digital infrastructure. So radio, TV stations, internet access, cellular phones, all of those kinds of things that we often take for granted. And I mostly look at things from the beginning of the Oslo Accords in the early mid 90s and kind of sort of move forward. And while of course there's been many changes along the way, I think there is a way in which I can maybe sort of sum up the what I will detail, but I can kind of sum up that the world of media infrastructure in Palestine is that these infrastructures produce and maintain the fragmentation of Palestinian territory. They entrench the Palestinian economic dependency and de-development in many forms, and they enable Israeli territorial expansion. Now, those things are often kind of referred to as part and parcel of regular sort of Israeli occupation or kind of colonial presence. But I'm looking at this specifically from this level of infrastructure. And this is something that I've called digital occupation. And so what I'd like to do today is to sort of provide a very brief history and a couple of examples of what this digital occupation of Palestine is. And the point of doing that is really sort of, it's not to focus so much on content, but to understand the base or the infrastructure on which content actually becomes possible. So it's a slightly different focus than what my panelists will be doing, but they'll be talking more about what people do and how and so on. So the focus on the infrastructural level is really on this kind of material, the cables, the wires, the landlines, the machines, all of those things that actually make up our digital world. And so this requires one to look at the technical aspects of how these technologies function, as well as the legal aspects. So things like who controls the airwaves, who controls cellular signals and bandwidth, and economic issues about ownership, about revenue streams, and so on. And so sometimes I'll say media infrastructure, sometimes I'll say telecom infrastructure. I think for most of today, I'm really sort of using these interchangeably, but to refer largely to this whole set of things from radio signals to fiber optic and coaxial cables, to Wi-Fi connections, to routers and exchanges, and all of those types of things for which data can only travel and circulate because of these sorts of because of the sort of infrastructure. And here's why this level of analysis, I guess, is important, or why it matters, or what is actually at stake here, is that in the same way that we can focus on the question of the containment of Palestine and and Palestinian land and territory, and the question of Israeli expansion of territory, telecom and media is actually another space that shapes the containment of Palestine and of its borders and of its spatiality. So digital occupation for me is really this sort of process of this act of containment that is aimed at transforming Palestinian space, right? And infrastructure for me is not a metaphor for the conflict, but it actually is the conflict in very material built form. So very briefly, just to sort of understand like, how we've gotten to this point is under formal, and I guess what you could call under formal Israeli occupation, like from 67 to 93 or so on, Palestinians who were living in what was then at least called the occupied territories, right, were denied their own technology and media infrastructure. So there's no such thing at the in that moment as Palestinian television or radio stations. Telephone lines were extremely difficult to get. Something like less than 2% of the population even had telephone access. I mean, in terms of like connection to their house. They had to wait, 10 years or more to get a telephone line. There was no sort of local broadcasting of any kind. And by the early 1990s, anybody who was trying to connect to the internet had to physically do so through a dial-up, either through Israel or through a service provider in another country. So you would actually dial up to a British, for example, provider. So these sorts of restrictions were kind of like the norm up until the early 90s. And then when the Oslo Accords were signed, by the time the second round of the Oslo Accords were signed in the mid 90s, the Palestinian Authority was given permission to build some of its own infrastructure. But this is what's actually critically important, is that while it was allowed to build its infrastructure or give permission to firms to build infrastructure, it was with extremely strict limitations, so that all Palestinian technology infrastructures are ultimately, until today, determined by Israeli decisions, right? So what are the speeds that internet access is allowed to function at? What's the spectrum allocation? What are the broadcasting rights? All of these things are ultimately controlled either by the Israeli Ministry of Communication, their policies, sometimes through military action, and more generally through the kind of, you know, the regime of ongoing occupation. So I'm going to show you a couple of slides just to sort of try to help visualize. Help visualize some of this. So I don't know how large this is.
I think we can see it nicely.
So this is like a zoomed in map of part of the West Bank. And I don't know if you can see it very well, but that sort of little collection of green dots kind of in the middle of the screen, that's Ramallah, okay? And what this shows is actually, this is the telecommunications, I guess permissions map is sort of what I would call it. Everything that's within these red lines is where the Palestinian Authority is allowed to build actual infrastructure. So this is where they can dig for fiber optic cables. This is where they can install cellular towers. This is where they can install machinery and so on. And just for reference, those green dots are actually cell phone towers. Okay, but it's a little different now, but more or less, this is sort of what it looks like. And what you can see is this sort of very pocketed territory of where infrastructure is permitted. So on the whole then, telephone, internet, television systems, as well as other infrastructures that we sometimes talk about, like roads and sewage and healthcare, are purposefully limited and contained in terms of where they're allowed to be built. So as far as infrastructure is concerned, usually these limitations are imposed by, you know, Israeli security concerns, which usually means restrictions over Palestinians and resulting in systems that kind of prevent Palestinians often from connecting to each other or even to international networks, unless it's through Israeli conduits. So for example, telephone and internet connection is extremely limited. Landline telephone calls made on a Palestinian telecom network between one neighborhood and another, whether in Gaza, between Nablus and Ramallah, in Jericho, have to physically be connected through an Israeli telephone provider. So a call is physically routed through Israel at any moment. The same is true for international phone calls, obviously, whether these take place on land or cellular networks, both to and from the territories, they're all routed through Israel. And the same is true for things like internet access. So while it might look from a consumer perspective like you're paying your bill to Paltel or to Jawal or to some local provider, that local provider ultimately has to get permission and connection through an Israeli provider. Not for free, of course, but for a pretty steep price. So what this suggests is that, you know, the production and control over Palestine's containment are both conventional, like roads and settlements, but also new. They're real and they're abstract, they're physical and they're cyber. And that what you can tell is that digital infrastructure or media infrastructure becomes very territorially defined in terms of where it's actually allowed to be built. Let me give you a slightly different example, which is, you kind of have to look a little carefully. There is a tiny little signal under the Palestinian one, right? So this actually compares the amount of spectrum allocation that is given for the Israeli cellular providers compared to the Palestinian cellular providers, right? So this is an example, if you want, of how policy also impacts sort of internet connection, telephone connection, all kinds of different media infrastructures. So the bandwidth is administered through the Israeli Ministry of Communication. Israeli providers are given something like a little more than 2,000% more cellular bandwidth than Palestinian ones. And for the most part, until today, the Palestinian cellular infrastructure still functions largely either on a 2G or a 3G network. What that means as a user is that, you know, your connections are slow. There's many parts, if you kind of remember the map, there's many parts where you just simply do not have connection. It's incredibly expensive. Your smartphone is mostly useless because it doesn't really work on a 2G or 3G network. So you can't do things like live mapping or traffic reports or online banking or all sorts of things that we've sort of taken for granted, right? So, and at the same time, you know, so all of these measures kind of taken together, where infrastructure is permitted to be built, what kind, how high the towers can be, at what signal can they actually beam, and so on. All of these taken together largely contain Palestinian flows according to Israeli defined territorial boundaries, which largely prevent, limit, or thwart Palestinian national and international connections. These very same borders, if you want to call them that, are actually largely irrelevant to Israeli flows, right? So if I have the privilege of having an Israeli cell phone, for example, I can be just about anywhere in the West Bank. I could be driving up and down the West Bank. I will probably never lose my cell phone call. I can do my online banking. I can do my online dating. I can do like FaceTime and Zooming and all of that, and get my live traffic conditions, even if I'm all the way sort of like, you know, somewhere in the Jordan Valley. That's on my Israeli phone and on the Israeli network. The same cannot be said for, obviously, for the Palestinian network. So this is, in a way, kind of the example of, that I wanted to just sort of get to, of what digital occupation means. So for me, digital occupation is not so much about, I guess the way I'd sort of summarize it is that the official occupation, if you want to call it that, never ended with the peace agreements or with the introduction of the Palestinian Authority or with the blockade or the settler pullout of Gaza. Instead, occupation has actually shifted from this sort of direct Israeli control that we used to know before the 90s towards something that's more akin to this digital occupation. And so telecom, media, these play an incredibly important role, both as the driver, but also the kind of microcosm of this reformulation of Israeli power since the mid-1990s onwards. So checkpoints and roads, for example, can be thought of as, you know, a very obvious territorial marker of the strategy of containing Palestinians and expansion for Israelis, but telephone lines and internet connections are actually functioning in pretty much a similar way. So in short, the development of the development of telecom and media infrastructure can be told as this dynamic historical account, but also as a spatial structure of power in today's digital age, or the way in which the territorialization of power through digital networks actually happens. So the political significance is really profound. This isn't simply about whether somebody can make a phone call or whether internet access is available and at what price and where, but it's ultimately about what kind of state is made possible or impossible or contained according to the infrastructural developments that are permitted. Thank you.
Okay, great. Thank you very much, Helga. This is very fascinating. I have to admit that I fell in love with the term digital occupation since I read your article, the journal article. I wanted to ask you very quickly, because then we move to Dima, and any questions, we are going to take them after the contributions. Has anyone used this term before you? Because I wanted to give you the credit for this, that you have coined maybe the term itself, digital occupation, because I'm using digital colonialism in one of my books now.
Yeah. I mean, not that I know of. I think I want to say I coined the term, but you know, who knows? Digital colonialism is something that has been around in terms of the term for a little bit longer, though.
Yeah. Well, we give you the credit and really great kind of, it's fair enough, of course, to raise our hat for coining this this term and even having it in the public sphere now to be used. Let's move to Dima. Dima Khatib. Dima directs the award-winning AG Plus. I think everyone knows of this. This is with the four channel language-driven versions, English, Arabic, Spanish, and French. Dima is the only female executive within Al Jazeera, Jazeera Network. She joined the network back in 1997 as a junior broadcast journalist in Qatar. Then later on, Dima set up bureaus in China, Venezuela, Latin America. She is very well known over there, reporting for many, many years. In 25 years, she reported from over than 30 countries, interviewing presidents and people from all walks of life. Dima has been classified as among the most influential Arabs on social media. She speaks 8 languages. I envy you, Dima, for this, and has one published book in Arabic, Love Refugee. Now, Dima has been engaged in all sorts of media. So my job and my tough job is how to stop her, because I love to just to listen to her experience and engagement on social media, mainstream media, AG+, and this and that. Now, she will talk about digital censorship on Palestine-related content on social media with some maybe kind of focus on the very latest round of conflict in this in the previous weeks. So Dima, the mic is yours.
Thank you, Khaled. Pleased to be here with you. And please stop me if I take too long. This is such a rich topic for me, obviously. So we all followed the beginning of this. It was Save Sheikh Jarrah hashtag that was launched by activists from the ground and from around the world to talk about this neighborhood in Jerusalem, in occupied East Jerusalem, where many Palestinian families were threatened to be evicted, as put by several, by most media, actually, organizations, forcibly displaced, dispossessed, depending on who you are reading or watching. And it generated a social media explosion in a sense that the interest that we saw in this matter was different, dramatically different from other times. And it culminated on 10th of May in the social media explosion of the coverage of Israeli soldiers going into Al-Aqsa Mosque in Jerusalem and attacking worshippers. And that was transmitted live on Instagram, much more than live TV stations. So, you know, Instagram has this new feature where you can host up to 4 people at the same time. And activists who are Palestinian and pro-Palestinian from around the world use this to get the biggest exposure possible. So someone with 2 million or 3 million followers on Instagram would just join the live. They have nothing to say. They just join the live to give exposure to the person who is in Jerusalem, who is in the mosque, and who is going live from the mosque, and others with maybe 1 million, 30,000, whatever, just giving a voice, a platform to that person who has a cell phone and who has knowledge of what's happening and who's just showing live images. That was impressive. I mean, some of those lives got to 30, 60,000 views at a time. And it went on for a few days from Sheikh Jarrah neighborhood, then when the bombing started on Gaza, they continued. And I was amazed that Instagram was allowing this kind of exposure for Palestine. I was really amazed. And then suddenly, things changed. Suddenly, it was not 30,000 or 60,000 anymore. And suddenly, even though big accounts were going live on Instagram, they were not getting the big exposure. Suddenly, stories on Instagram, my own being one, were not appearing on the followers' feed like they were in the early days, like they usually are. And suddenly I myself saw that exposure on my stories on Instagram went down like from thousands within the first hour to not even a few hundreds after 24 hours. So we also noticed, I'm gonna share with you some screenshots that we got of how our content was. Can you see the slides?
Yes.
Okay, so we took these shots from our Instagram accounts, Al Jazeera's, different ones. And you can see that all of them have suffered from this kind of, it's not really, they're hiding the thumbnail of the story. And when you try and share it, they ask you, this is sensitive content, you have to actually pay attention to say share anyway. The first thing you would actually do is cancel, because that's the first option it's giving you automatically. So most people would fall into the cancel. Now, going back to the content that was shaded like this, you look at the stories. If you look at AJ plus Arabi, this story, Ibtisamat al-Atiqal, which is how Palestinians resist occupation by smiling when they're arrested. The same story, we had it in Ajota plus Español, and we had it in Francais. It was okay in Espanol, and then in French, it was censored. So how come it was okay in Arabic and Spanish, but it was not okay in French? It's exactly the same story. Another story that I remember was censored this way was about pro-Palestinian Jewish communities. There is nothing in those stories that goes against community rules of Instagram. Nothing, absolutely nothing. So we talked to Instagram. We did not like this because obviously it does not only affect the story. I have to say it affects the reach of your account when this happens. So, and it stops you from promoting that particular story if you want to promote it. We don't promote our content. Alhamdulillah, our content is very popular, but other people may use promotion to spread their content. So Instagram said, oh, sorry, that was a mistake. And they removed some of the censorship, and we proved to them that there was nothing wrong with our story. So I'm talking about hundreds of Instagram accounts that faced the same issue. And by the time Instagram responded, you know, we lost time, we lost exposure, and we lost the momentum of this, what I called a social media explosion for Palestine, that was shying away from the coverage of traditional media and sticking to all those activists. And they were joined by fashionistas, by chefs, by people who write about, I don't know, motherhood. All kinds of people on Instagram joined the movement, Palestinian and non-Palestinian. And it was really impressive to see how this young generation of TikTok and Instagram was engaged, even when they're usually talking about things that are apolitical, such as fashion and makeup. But when the moment came, they used their exposure and their audience for a cause they believe in. It was impressive. Anyway, so back to the censorship. The thing is, if you go through what was not censored, it was that. It was the traditional media that talked about property disputes, not dispossessions, not forced displacement, not Nakba, not contextualization. This kind of content was not censored by Instagram and Facebook. And I have to say, I didn't notice any censorship by Twitter on content, maybe hashtags, but our content was not censored on Twitter. You can see here, I gathered from an AJ Plus report, they're all talking about evictions. So the language used by those censored was not that of an eviction and land dispute. It was that of a ethnic cleansing. That was the part that was always censored. All of these media organizations were not censored. Then you go again, annexed East Jerusalem. You know, the word occupation is kind of like put aside, annexed. It's a very, what's annexed? Nobody really knows what's annexed. And then clashes. And if you go all of these media organizations were not censored. They were all talking about clashes, whereas the activists who were doing lives were talking about an assault from soldiers against Palestinians who are peacefully praying. So calling it clashes is really unfair, and it does not represent what really happened. We go again. So here, when in 1948 territories where the state of Israel was made, there are Palestinians. You can see here, they talk about quell riots between Arabs and Jews. This Arabs and Jews is the Zionist narrative. It's the Israeli narratives of calling Palestinians Arabs, because this way it can send them to any other Arab country to spend the rest of their life and does not have to acknowledge that there are Arab Jews as well. So this goes completely into the Israeli narrative, and you can see how media says that, oh, well, it's always been okay. What happened suddenly? It's like everybody's surprised. Good relations, you know? Years of quiet. As if there is no context there. As if there is no 73 years of Palestinians being denied their existence as a nation. So all these media organizations who are not censored can carry on with this narrative that activists were contesting and were challenging on social media. Then again, I found that absolutely fascinating when media calls it the Hamas health ministry. And you know, so many media organizations keep doing this. Nobody calls it the Likud health ministry, you know? They call it the Hamas health ministry. And you can see that the framing by so many mainstream media organizations is always Israel Hamas, as if it started just in this exchange, what is called exchange, and as if there's no Palestine and there's no Palestinian people. It's just like this kind of thing called Hamas. And you can see here that it says in the AP, in the AP wire, it says Gaza children bearing the brunt in Israel Hamas conflict. Palestinians go on strike as Israel Hamas fighting rages, as if Palestinians were completely separated from the military operation that's happening. And this is constant, and that's what activists have been challenging, and they've been going after all of these organizations to say, you're biased, this framing is wrong, there's no contextualization. Again, now Israel is always responding because it's defending itself. It's always responding because it's the victim. And that, again, is portrayed, is the way it's portrayed in media organizations and even in Storyful. And Storyful, those who don't know it, is a user-generated agency that takes the content from from social media, verifies it, and then distributes it to its subscribers. So we use Storyful as one of our main sources of user-generated content. Even Storyful, which is based in social media sphere, uses retaliatory airstrike when it talks about Israel bombing Gaza. And you can see here that Storyful posted, yes, I'm about to finish. You can see Storyful here not even bothered to verify. This is user-generated content. So this is somebody that posted this from Gaza, okay? And Storyful chooses this very politicized headline from the Israeli point of view on a user-generated Palestinian content from Gaza. This really shocked me, to see that Storyful would be doing the same thing as the mainstream media. And then again, Palestinians always die, but Israelis are killed, right? Palestinians somehow die, and also buildings collapse. Palestinians die and buildings collapse. Nobody puts a responsibility on Israel in that kind of framing. Anyway, I can go on for hours about this. I will stop here.
Okay, Dima, this is really very fascinating. Thank you very much for this. Now you you have gotten us into the real business of this very fine latest round of wars on Palestine. And in terms of how the media has been dealing with everything, and then this assumption that equal parties and then Palestinians always are dying for some unknown reasons, and whereas Israelis are killed deliberately by the known perpetrator. So I'm not going to take more time of the maybe potential questions, and let me move to our third speaker, Kareem Darwish. Kareem has a very impressive biography, I have to say. I have learned from your biography, Kareem, some technical kind of stuff. Somebody is, yeah, Kareem. Let me, something happened on my screen. If you can unshare Kareem for just 1 second. If you can unshare the screen, please. If you can unshare the slide. Do you hear me, Kareem? You are muted, maybe. Kareem, can you hear me? You are muted.
Yes, I can hear you. I'm trying to unshare the screen.
Yeah, if you please, because something if you can unshare it.
I'm trying. I just don't see where the thing for stop record.
I think it could be on the top.
Stop share. Okay, there we go. Sorry.
Because things suddenly, maybe when you shared the screen. Anyway, so Kareem is our third speaker. He is a principal scientist and acting research director of the Arabic Language Technologies Group. And this is at Qatar Computing Research Institute, with interest in information retrieval, digital libraries, and natural language processing. Kareem worked as a researcher at the Cairo Microsoft Innovation Lab and at the IBM Human Language Technologies Group in Cairo. He also taught at the German University in Cairo and Cairo University itself. Now, this is very interesting, kind of this paragraph. So maybe it's a few lines, but I learned a lot from them. I want kind of to read them. Very technical, but very informative. His research on natural language processing has led to state-of-the-art tools for Arabic processing that perform several tasks, such as part of speech tagging, named entity recognition, automatic diacritic recovery, sentiment analysis, and parsing. His work on social computing focused on predictive stance detection, on to predict how users feel about an issue now or perhaps in the future, and on detecting malicious behavior on social media platform. So I think, Kareem, I'm going to pay you a visit once I am back in Doha to learn more about all these things. Now, aside from the technicalities, Kareem has published in Arabic and English in politics and social psychology. He will focus in his talk on the analysis, on his analysis of Twitter users, including those with the pro and anti-Palestinian views. There is a research that he has led that conducted certain analysis on Arabic and English tweets, including some subsets of English tweets from the US. Kareem, without further ado, I'm gonna leave you with this to share with us your outcome, your results, and analysis. There you go.
So thank you for the kind introduction. If you don't mind, let me share my screen. So my name is Kareem Darwish, as Dr. Khaled said. And I'm going to be taking you know, kind of a social media perspective on what was happening over the span of 3 days from a point of view of pro-Palestinian and pro-Israeli social media, specifically tweets. And to put things in perspective, we did a collection of, as I said, over 3 days. And we divided tweets between ones that are in Arabic, ones that are in English, and specifically ones that come from the US. And as you can see from the numbers there, the numbers are actually quite big. So like 4 million tweets in English, 1.5 million tweets in Arabic, and so forth. So when you actually start looking at social media, certain things start popping up and you start seeing, you know, specific trends and so forth. And one of the things that that Khaled mentioned was stance detection. This is something that we do very, very well. We're basically given a large collection of tweets. We can actually divide users into different groups based on their position. So one of the things that immediately came out of the analysis was we noticed that the majority of users actually had pro-Palestinian views as opposed to pro-Israeli views. And not only for the general English speaking, you know, tweets where only 8% were pro Israeli, but even for US users, less than a quarter of them had the pro Israeli views. And the difference was not that much from, I mean, the same thing you can actually see for Arabic tweets also. So there is an overwhelming, you know, pro-Palestinian, position among social media users. And this cuts across different languages and even as we can see in US tweets. So that's the first take home here. The second thing we looked at, now that we know that all these users, where they are, you can actually start looking at what kind of things they say. So for example, if you look at the top hashtags for pro-Palestinian and pro-Israeli users, you can actually start seeing some of the kind of frames that people were using. And I'm going to go into frames a little bit more as in the next slide. So so that's one part that I'll show you in the next slide. But I think one of the more interesting things, and if you look at the top retweeted accounts, you see, and these are US users, AJ English, number one, AJ Plus, number two, Middle East I, number four, Mahdi Hassan, number five. So you see that regional media is making a huge impact, not just regionally, but also in the US. And I think this is really, really significant. And you can, so this is one part as far as who's getting retweeted. And if you look at the top articles, where are they coming from for the pro-Palestinian users? Al Jazeera is there again. Middle East Monitor and Middle East Eye are also there. So again, regional media has a large impact. And the one surprising part for me, at least, was the Washington Post was actually being cited a lot by pro-Palestinian users. And this kind of signals some of the shift that we're actually seeing in US media on the topic of the Palestinian-Israeli conflict. If you look at the other side, they're citing the IDF, not surprisingly, the Israeli Defense Force. Breitbart, all the usual suspects are there for supporting the Israeli side. As far as the framing is concerned, you can see that the people who are pro-Palestinian, I mean, they have very, very specific frames that they're pushing. One has to do with US policy, and like this is a tweet from AOC, complaining about the funding of Israel. And this is something that, you know, this is a voice that is becoming more louder and louder in the US. Again, there's another frame concerning Israeli crimes. And the last one is actually interesting, and this is kind of feeds into what Dima was talking about, that, you know, there's a quarter of a million people protesting in one city and not a single news report. And this is kind of surprising. Also, the people were complaining that, the same thing that Zima mentioned, Hamas run Gaza Ministry of Health. No one actually ever says that, right? It's the Ministry of Health in every other country. But this is how the CNN was actually referring to the Ministry of Health. If you look at the other side, the people who are pro-Israeli, you see the same typical, frames for projecting their views. There's an issue of anti-Semitism that Hamas, apologists attacking Jews in different places. Hamas is the problem because they're firing rockets and Israel is defending itself. But there's actually a new frame, which I think is becoming more and more prominent, is the relationship between the Black Lives the Black Lives Matter movement and the Palestinian issue. And this is something that is actually the other the pro-Israeli side is actually taking a lot of notice of. Let me just shift to the Arab side. These are Arabic tweets, and if you don't speak Arabic, you know, forgive me. But you know, I think this is very, very instructive to see how the side of the how people in the Arab world are seeing this conflict. We actually found four main groups of people that are actually talking about the conflict. One group is obviously pro-Palestinian and is closely tied to the Arab Spring. And I just want you to look at one of these hashtags, like, you know, overthrowing the regime, talking about Egypt, will save the Nile. The first one is, you know, resist like a Palestinian and save the Nile. And there are other ones, you know, that I cannot list all of them, but there are things related to Haftar, they're related to other places where, you know, the Arab Spring had happened. So there's a very, very strong connection between being pro-Palestinian and you know, from an Arab context and being pro-Arab Spring at the same time. There's another group that is pro-Iran, very, very clearly. They talk about, you know, Iran, you know, supporting, you know, the resistance to liberate Palestine and so forth. They talk about the Houthis and so forth. And then the third group is a pro Saudi Arabia, pro United Arab Emirates, and pro Egypt, and you know, they have the typical frames, which I'm going to show you in just a second. And the media sources that each side cites kind of aligns with this, right? There's Al Jazeera on one side and TRT, which is the Turkish you know, agency on one side, Dini Shafak and so forth, and Yuma Saba Al Arabiya on the other side. It's very, very clear. You can see the separation, and this has been the separation since even the start of the Arab Spring. The frames, so I know I don't want to, you know, probably Khaled is looking at his watch. You know, give me about 2 or 3 minutes.
Okay, so still you have 6 minutes, okay. Or 5 minutes.
Okay, fantastic. Okay. If you look at the main frames for people who are pro-Palestinian, you know, they talk about Israeli war crimes. They talk about Israel losing the war, like, you know, activists are mocking, you know, Netanyahu because, you know, he's trying to get, you know, comfort from 70 different, you know, ambassadors and trying to project that he's doing well, but while he's losing. There's also another, you know, frame where it's anti-local Israeli allies. So this is like a Kuwaiti doctor who's refusing to go to Emirates. Because, you know, they have some relationship with Israel, you know, and so on and so forth. And it talks about also international solidarity. And the last frame that Dima mentioned very, very clearly was the internet censorship. And if you were following what was happening on social media, there was a huge campaign against Facebook to downmark them as far as, you know, the number of stars they get in the App Store, and actually tying directly, like, Facebook yaktum al-haqiqa, Facebook, you know, tries to, you know, suppress truth, and it's actually a partner in death in Gaza. So I mean, the frame is very, very clear. I'm going to jump directly to the other frame, which is the kind of the Egyptian / Saudi / Emirati, you know, frame of reporting on the story. And this kind of the more the official, you know, I can almost say that they follow the official line of some of these states, right? So the first one is saying, oh, is Palestinians are traitors, they're pro-Iran, they're sellouts and so forth, and they are the reason for all the misery that the Palestinians are facing. And this is a very consistent frame where they say, you know, Hamas is the reason why Gaza is being bombed. And, you know, Haniyeh is actually going and giving condolences in the death of Soleimani and so forth. And the son of Mahmoud Abbas is a billionaire who's stealing money. So that's on one side. And the other frame is the reconstruction where Egypt is being projected as a savior of the people of Gaza, and they reconstruct, you know, Gaza after the destruction that was brought on it by you know, the Palestinians themselves, they brought on themselves the destruction, and the Egyptians are there to save them. And the last one is an anti-Turkey, anti-Iran frame. So these are kinds of the frames that you can actually see in the data that we've collected. There are a few other things that I want to point out in the minute or two that I have left. If you look at the at Arab users, they're actually tweeting in both Arabic and English, which is very, very interesting, that you know that they're trying to get their voices heard beyond the you know the typical you know local regional type spheres. Regional media is very, very powerful, and they're being heard in the West very loudly and very clearly. Also, there's a very strong alignment between what people's perception of the Palestinian issue and what they felt about the Arab Spring, and this is actually quite interesting. There is some shift that we're seeing in even US media that is becoming, I mean, I don't want to say that they're moving, you know, to be pro-Palestinian, but they're not as extreme in their in their pro-Israeli view. I could be wrong, and it could be just a blimp, but maybe others can comment on this. And I think I took too much of your time, and thank you so much.
Well, this is fantastic, Kareem. Thank you very much. Huge an effort, I must say. And again, maybe we will ask you for the full kind of results and reports out of this great research. And now let's kind of move to our colleague and friend, Marc Owen Jones, our fourth speaker. Marc is an assistant professor of Middle East Studies at Hamad bin Khalifa University, where he lectures and researches political repression and informational control strategies. His recent work has focused on the way social media has been used to spread disinformation and fake news in the Middle East. In March 2019, he published The Gulf Information War, a fantastic book, Propaganda, Fake News, and Fake Trends, The Weaponization of Twitter Bots in the Gulf Crisis. And then his upcoming book on the disinformation and deception in the Middle East will be published by Hearst Books in London and Oxford University Press. Marc has been engaged in social media, and we have, I think at NUQ, we have hosted him a couple of times. We learned from him and from his meticulous, very precise and up-to-date work and research. He will talk, and as he used to, he will take one kind of single issue and he will delve into it so deeply and will come up with the great kind of results. In his talk today, he will focus on this hashtag, maybe many of us have known of it, called Palestine ليست قضيتي, Palestine is not my cause. So he examined this hashtag, maybe the origin, the source, and the trending, and so on and so forth, by way of siphoning any Arab support of the Palestinian cause. So Marc, over to you.
Thank you, Khaled, for that introduction. It's great to be here. It's great to be with so many great speakers and friends. I'm just going to share my screen. Forgive the bright colors. I thought, you know, since it was 7 p.m., people could do with a pick-me-up. and without coffee, I thought this was the next best thing. So today I'm going to be talking about a specific hashtag, which is Palestine ليست قضيتي, which is Palestine is not our cause. And this is a very interesting hashtag because I think it's, you know, I focus really on the negative impacts of technology. And again, there was a lot of fanfare about social media and its potential to democratize, to generate solidarity between minority groups and marginalized communities. And I'm not saying that doesn't exist. Of course, that still exists, but it doesn't mean that there's not scope for manipulation, a lot of which we see in the Gulf. And I think the recent attacks on Gaza are a really interesting case study in how we see attempts within the Arabic speaking world to remove solidarity and try and diminish support for the Palestinian cause, which is obviously a very toxic development. Not that it hasn't happened before, but I think it's very interesting to see that in the social media space. The context for a lot of this, what I'll be talking about, is the normalization with the United Arab Emirates, Bahrain, with Israel, which began last year. Now, this is an interesting moment, obviously, because you know, for the first time in a long time, Arab states have been have struck up a public relationship with Israel, obviously generating a lot of you know, kind of discontent with domestic publics in those countries. And again, it's not surprising that many, particularly autocratic regimes in the Arab world, disregard the feelings of their populations in order to pursue practical interests. And this is very much part of the New Gulf moment. If we look at the New Gulf moment as this increasingly bold attempt, mostly by the United Arab Emirates and Saudi Arabia, to kind of take a leadership role in the region and to take up a new mantle and sort of generate a new GCC. And obviously we saw this really begin to take shape in 2017 when Egypt, Bahrain, Saudi and UAE blockaded Qatar. You know, this kind of moment has been a very interesting one. And obviously with the rise of Trump, you know, this whole, there's been a movement to contain Iran and Saudi and the United Arab Emirates have obviously been very keen to kind of use Trump's support of Israel and anti-Iranian stance to kind of contain Iran within the region. So any perceived support for Iran is a frowned upon. And part and parcel of this whole package is that the Gulf states have sought to normalize with Israel, who again are advocating for the containment of Iran. So this moment is very key. And obviously that relationship with Israel is kind of crucial to this because, you know, what are Gulf states or autocratic Gulf states who want to normalize Israel going to do when they know their populations for the most part are largely sympathetic to the Palestinian cause? Because no matter how autocratic you are as a state, you can't completely abandon the kind of your regard for public opinion, lest you provoke another revolution. And we know that certain states in the region obviously don't want to do that. And so, you know, what we've seen being built over the past 4 or 5 years to kind of deal with these big changes in Gulf policy is attempt to manipulate the sort of public awareness, public consciousness about multiple issues, not just Palestine. And so a huge instrument of this has been the manipulation of social media. Media in general, and I know my colleagues here have talked a lot about more, you know, legacy media, which is, you know, it's increasingly nebulous, you know, because, you know, obviously when people watch, say, Al Jazeera, they still share the videos on social media. So there is a lot of crossover, but I'm particularly talking about Twitter and things like Facebook and Instagram. So the fact that these platforms were seen as giving citizens the ability to communicate their thoughts obviously posed big challenges to authoritarian regimes because they no longer, or in theory, their ability to control the narratives through vertically controlled media outlets was challenged. And so we've seen over the past 10 years how the number of different ways that these regimes have been able to try and co-opt social media in order to kind of convey their narratives. And one of the ways they've done that is, you know, automated accounts on Twitter, for example. You know, if you want to generate a specific, you know, narrative, for example, in 2017, when the blockade started, we saw thousands and thousands of automated bot accounts promoting the blockading countries' narratives about Qatar in particular. But we see this constantly. I've documented thousands of automated accounts on Twitter promoting sectarian hate speech, anti-Shia, sectarian hate speech. And so, you know, and generally other forms of harassment and control, you know, you have armies of trolls intimidating critics of, say, the government. We've seen increasingly in Saudi Arabia, hyper-nationalism emerge where there's hundreds or thousands of accounts with pictures of Mohammed bin Salman who intimidate those who criticize his reforms. That coupled with the offline intimidation, killing, harassment of activists and journalists obviously creates a kind of an environment in which dissent is limited. And when dissent is limited, there's also a vacuum, and that vacuum is then filled by propaganda accounts and trolls and certain discourses. So, I mean, I think that there's a strong argument to say a lot of Gulf social media space has been co-opted to a large extent. And just in terms of those who want some empirical kind of meat on these bones, you know, if you the funny thing is, if you look at, for example, Twitter's takedown, state-backed information operations takedown archive, which Twitter release accounts that are known to have been connected to state manipulation efforts. Those archives are definitely not complete. There's way more manipulation than Twitter let on about. But as a sort of barometer, this is quite interesting, because if you collate Twitter's takedowns of Saudi, UAE, and Egypt, they are probably the second biggest known manipulators of social media after China, right? And there's a tendency in disinformation studies, social media, to focus on Russia and China and Iran as bad actors. But what's actually very interesting is that these countries themselves are probably some of the worst offenders when it comes to social media manipulation. And so when it comes to normalization, which obviously the UAE have done and Bahrain have, and people have suspected that the Saudi leadership want to do that, how is social media then being used to try and nudge or push social media users, Arabic speaking social medias, in towards a favorable or approaching normalization with some sort of favor? Well, one of the ways that this is done is to do astroturfing. And astroturfing means artificial grassroots, right? You create the illusion of public opinion. You create the illusion of public support for a certain policy position. And how do you create that illusion? Well, you either have a group of genuine people, whether influencers or people on working on troll farms and bots, who promote the state narrative or a certain narrative. It might not be the state narrative, but it could be a narrative generated by some political entity. And in this case, the entity that would benefit from this hashtag, Palestine is not our cause, could be those Arab states favoring normalization. It could be Israel, right? Without a smoking gun, knowing who's behind it, we don't know. But what's interesting about this hashtag, it started kind of cropping up last year in about April, right? So a few months prior to the announcement of normalization. I looked at a sample of about 17,000 interactions from April 2020 and May 2020. I did a network graph to see who was behind this hashtag. Because obviously when you see a hashtag trending, you don't necessarily know where it starts, where it begins. And so you can use various methods such as network analysis to deduce who the most influential nodes are on that. So what you see in front of you is a network graph. For those who are less familiar, network graph is a Twitter network graph where the circles or the nodes represent an individual account. In this case, the larger the node, the more retweeted that particular account was. The lines between each node are either retweets, mentions, or interactions between two accounts. And so what you can kind of see on this map is there's a group in the, if you look on the right side or the top right quadrant, largely a group of Saudi-based accounts or Saudi nationalist accounts, many of which have the Saudi flag in their profiles. I've put two samples here of some of the tweets, many of which were retweeted thousands of times. Finding reasons to say why Palestine should not be the cause of certainly Saudis. And a lot of these to do with, Palestinians are ungrateful, or Palestinians are trying to undermine the Kingdom of Saudi, and these kind of things. And it's a very, Saudi first kind of rhetoric, right? You can even see, one of the most common, I think, phrases on this was Saudi first. And so this kind of rise of nationalism and populism that we've seen in a global context of right-wing populism is also obviously evident in the Gulf. And if you analyze the location, and location, again, this should be taken with a grain of salt, but the majority of the accounts generating or tweeting on this Palestine is not a cause hashtag are Saudi-based. Just like a qualifier as well, when this started trending, there was also a backlash, and the backlash, I think, actually became bigger than this artificial hashtag, right? And so, there were some funny tweets from people who were obviously pushing back on this. I think one of them was along the lines of course, Palestine is not your cause. The cause is for honorable people, right? So there was like a lot of pushback against this kind of this obvious propaganda, which was interesting. But what was super interesting about the Gaza under attack thing is we saw again a spike in this hashtag of Palestine and Laysat Qadiyati at the outset of the Israeli attacks on Gaza. So what that meant, again, is like when obviously you have this global outpouring of support for the Palestinian cause, as my colleagues have demonstrated, you then see this very tasteless and very problematic attempt to kind of diminish support and sympathy for those in Palestine, or you know, just generally those who support the Palestinians. And it was very interesting that there was a spike in this hashtag at that time. And so what we kind of see again is, I think what, when we talk about digital occupation, we're talking about the fact that even outside the realm of the geographic borders of Palestine, you know, when you look at the ability of certain actors, so for example, Gulf states with high technological penetration, high Twitter uptake, high mobile phone take up, they have, and high number of population, they have the ability potentially to disproportionately affect the discourse on social media around certain cases by manipulating or by using those, that digital media power, for want of a better term. It's probably under theorized. And so, you know, regardless of the occupation within Palestine, there's this ability that social media is also occupied to an extent by forces that are hostile to the Palestinian cause. And this is the reason why what could arguably be fringe cases like this hashtag are able to trend and are able to actually garner a lot of retention. And this is something we really have to kind of explore. How is it possible that these kind of hashtags are able to trend? And crucially, who is actually doing these? Are these hashtags the work of genuine citizens who are nationalists? It's unlikely. But without a smoking gun, it's very hard to kind of determine why these hashtags exist and why they take place. But given my own work on manipulation in the region, I think it's very likely that, you know, there's a co-opted group of influencers who have, you know, the ability to generate trends, but also because it's an authoritarian state, it's very hard for anyone to say anything the state disagrees with, and have that trend. So these trends would have the tacit support of those governments in which the people are based, generating them. And I think that's an interesting case, because what this is showing is it's not only that there is the ability to manipulate social media discourse about it, but there is somehow indicative of possibly, say, in this case, Saudi policy towards Israel, which we know, I think we have a sense that they want to kind of normalize, but they're trying to push their citizens in that direction using social media. So I'll stop there and allow people to ask questions. Thank you very much.
Okay, Marc. Thank you very much for this. This is very impressive as usual. It's really a pleasure to hear from you and about research. One thing that I think I must mention as a comment, quick comment on your research. A friend of mine early on the normalization agreement between Israel and United Arab Emirates mentioned to me that he was kind of interested in following some of these tweets, especially from Saudi Arabia and United Arab Emirates. And as you said, we don't have concrete proof, but for him, he could kind of trace down some of these tweets to even Israeli origins, using Saudi flags, Arabic names, Muhammad ibn Saud or whatever. And then I said, well, how could you be sure? He said, well, I'm not sure, but at least the language, the Saudi dialect that was used is very broken. This is not Saudi. Not a Saudi kind of individual would use this kind of terminology. And then he followed a bunch of these kind of tweets and they just kind of retweet each other. So maybe there is a research is needed to be done in this area. Okay, we have some time for questions and answers. Let me see the question and answer chat. So if you have any question, I think we have one that has been already answered by Helga. So our speakers, if you can just have a look as well. Some people ask for the, if they can have copies from the presentations. Well, I leave this to our authors. So please, if you have anything ready to share with us, send them to me or to Virginia, and we are gonna share them with others. There is one, maybe this is kind of more general kind of comment. There is another one, why is why is it that sometimes they seem hypocritical and the case of Palestinian promoting oil? Well, listen, guys, I'm going to leave it to you. So read these questions and see if you want to answer any of these. I know this is kind of very confusing on the Zoom and virtual kind of talks and lectures. While you are kind of reading the questions, I want to share with you one thing, one idea that has been coming to my mind while listening to the contributions, is that we have witnessed as well fake news and outright lies. So in fact, you will have kind of some big lie that has been somehow fabricated and became like viral. And then if you want to fix it, the damage has been already done. And then you can't, of course, fix the damage. You can maybe fix it, and people, okay, wow, this has been like a big lie or fake. One very recent example is there was this claim produced by Naftali Bennett, who could be the incoming prime minister. And in this clip, for maybe less than a minute, he showed, it was kind of a running, and he showed behind him, he showed a Shifa hospital, or what was assumed to be the Shifa hospital in Gaza, saying, well, underneath this hospital that is supposed to be civilian, Hamas stores, you know, rockets and weapons. Now, the image of that hospital comes from Islamabad, Pakistan. And then you can see, and of course you have arrows and some details in the picture and in the clip, but again, it went viral. And if you want to fix it, again, the damage has been already done there. So this, in fact, you know, took me back to one of my early research. I'm kind of trying to use the time while anyone of you raises their hand to answer any question. So please interrupt me. This is not my talk, this is your talk. Before I continue, anybody wants to answer any of these questions?
Yeah, sure. I'd love to answer the
first. Yes, go ahead. Yeah.
About how can oppressed publics and digital media users more broadly counter the hegemonic authority of social media, of high-tech companies? Yeah, this is something we think about a lot. And there is a call for alternative platforms. And there is one that showed up that became popular during the last few weeks, which is called Baz. It's developed, I think, and sponsored by Arabs. And it became popular because people were able to post whatever is being censored on Instagram and Facebook on Baz, uncensored. Now, I think that's a kind of half solution, because you cannot drive all the public, all the audiences from the other more popular platforms to these alternative platforms. I think maybe it's good to have both, because you can use them in times of crisis like that, but you cannot replace, you cannot completely replace Facebook or Instagram, I mean, or TikTok, they're so huge, or Twitter. You can try and manipulate your way through their algorithms. And I think Palestinians were very creative in breaking the algorithms of Instagram that were caging the content of Palestine and making it invisible. And I am using that even until today. If I post stories on Instagram just about Palestine, my reach is very low. If I post just two or three slides about my son playing the piano or doing pottery, my reach goes up to the thousands within hours. And, you know, so Palestinians have found ways to break through, you know, to break out of the cage of the algorithms, specifically on Instagram and Facebook, because they understood how it works. So I think tactics is one way at a time. So every time something happens, we kind of learn how to break through the algorithms. But also the strategy, which is creating alternative spaces. And ultimately, you know, we have to deal with whatever there is out there, because I think the positive is bigger than the negative in terms of us having used those platforms to our favor. I think we have used those platforms to our favor. And I think in my experience with AJ Plus, where we used Facebook immensely when we first started, I would say it's definitely like 10-0, you know, or 10-1, you know, in terms of if you're gonna, how many goals we have scored and how many goals Facebook has scored, because we did get the exposure we wanted. And Kareem showed how our media organizations, which are based back here, are influencing users in places like the United States, and taking over the space of the local media organizations, despite the digital occupation, despite digital apartheid, and despite digital colonization. Thank you.
Okay, Dima, thank you very much for this. We have some questions about the kind of digital awakening and what form and how much time should we invest in resisting digital occupation and this and that. Maybe I give 1 minute and a half or 2 minutes to each of our speakers, and then you can comment either on the questions or anything that you think is still pressing in your kind of mind and you want to make a final kind of statement or to conclude with. So let's start with Helga, if you like.
Sure, thanks. Yeah. I mean, I think that, you know, I can certainly echo what Dima was saying. I think you kind of have to think of all of these digital spaces as dynamic, right? I mean, this is for me part of what at least the term occupation can certainly signify, is that, you know, it's not just simply a negative thing, but you can occupy space, right, in a sort of more positive way if you want. So I think there are a number of ways in which there are certain tactics, right? So piggybacking off of different signals, sharing bandwidth, as Dima's examples showed, kind of figuring out how to work around algorithms, those types of things. I mean, I think for me in general, my concerns tend to be more the kind of political, economic kind of things that are hidden behind the scenes. So it's not so much, again, about the content, but about who's making money here, right? So it is the Googles and the Facebooks and the Cellcoms and the Israeli firms and the American firms and so on. So it's also about, you know, imagining how do we build different kinds of networks that are more locally governed, that are more democratic in a different sense, right? Like, so not just, again, not simply about the terminologies, but in terms of who can access and how do we go about accessing and at what prices and in what ways. So for me, it's a kind of a question of thinking about that as well. And as to the question of, you know, I mean, I can't really say how much time anybody needs to sort of put on this, but for me, all of these things are interrelated, right? Definitely I don't think of infrastructure as any separate from other realities on the ground in Palestine. But equally, I think, you know, as Palestinians, I mean, it's long been a kind of focus that, look, the narrative, the story, the circulation of that story is just as important as what's actually happening on the ground. So for me, it's a kind of multi-pronged battle, if you will, right? So yeah, you have to resist on the ground, but you also equally have to resist in the media landscape as well as otherwise. And I think, you know, certainly we all, as we increasingly live in a world in which we rely on internet connections and so on, that becomes so much more important.
Okay, Helga, thank you very much. Maybe Kareem, and if you like, I mean, this is up to you, if you like to comment on something. Yeah, one thing that I noticed in the slides that you have shown us is the New York Times is more cited by pro-Israel tweets and people, and the Washington Post.
That was the New York Post, not the New York Times.
Oh, I see.
It was the New York Post.
Then you offset my remark, you know, from the very beginning. So, however, my other kind of remark is the following. Again, feel free even not to comment on it if it doesn't fall in under your own research, which is, are we seeing a dramatic shift from mainstream media or the influence of mainstream media, which is, you know, again, the New York Times, or the Washington Post, the CNN, to social media. And people don't care, or at least the leverage and influence of the typical mainstream media is becoming kind of somehow diminished.
Let me try to address this question, and probably have another comment about what previous speakers have talked about. So concerning the, I mean, like, if you look at the most popular news sources that people were citing, you have, as I said, regional media from here, popular social media personalities, people on the ground, in different places, like people who are, as Dima was saying, said, were live streaming and so forth. So there's other voices that are coming into the fray, and people are listening to them. So that's one important aspect to this. The other thing, which is actually very, very important, has to do with the framing of the problem. I mean, if you look at the pro-Israeli users, they have very, very specific frames. Hamas is the problem, Israel is defending itself, and the IDF is the most moral, you know, army on the face of this planet, right? So there are very specific frames that are being pushed through their narrative, right? And I think some of these frames can be dismantled. And people are kind of sick and tired of some of these frames that are being, you know, repeated by the mainstream media. And people are saying, you know, if I discredit the frame that people are reporting from, then I'm in effect discrediting the person who's actually delivering the frame also. So it's very, very important to look at the talking points and dismantling them one by one. So that's one side of to the problem. Concerning the other issue, with the social media platforms, I have a friend of mine who started many, many years ago something that would try to compete with Facebook, and funding and business development is a huge problem. And it was actually even a problem for Facebook until they embraced they collect as much information as possible so we can do as targeted ads as possible. So the problem with platforms like this as alternatives is really where the money is, and hacking and figuring out where the money comes from is a huge deal, which goes back of how you can actually go back and actually fight back. So these people worry about, you know, making sure that their business is viable and they're making money. If you can do anything that would diminish their returns, you're actually serving yourself well. So things like boycotts of, you know, let's say boycotting Facebook or other platforms for like a day or two, or making sure that you don't click on any of their ads, or making sure that if you're an advertiser that you do not put ads on their website, on their platform and so forth. Maybe these are too simplistic, but if you sit down and think about, you know, where the money is coming from, and you try to stop at least a portion of that stream so they can take notice, that's very, very important. The last thing that I want to mention, and this goes back to what Marc has been talking about, as far as, you know, containing the media coverage and so forth. I think the biggest enemy of Israel is Israel itself. In the sense that, you know, to quote Shibli Talhami, if you've ever heard the name, he was a professor at the University of Maryland and so forth. He said, you know, people have worked on for like 20, 30 years to move the Palestinian problem from being an Islamic problem to an Arab problem to a Palestinian problem and then to a Gazan slash, you know, West Bank problem and so forth. Things, all the frames that have been built and, you know, all the isolation, all the containment just falls apart in one fell swoop. So God bless, you know.
Okay, Kareem, thank you very much. Over to you, Marc.
Yeah, thanks. I mean, I don't have a great deal to add, but I think some of the questions, I think that this question always comes up, or it has done for the past 10 years. And I think there's sometimes a not particularly useful debate that occurs of should people engage in online activism? And sometimes there's this derogatory notion of like, keyboard warriors, people who are just like tweeting or doing stuff online. And I don't think that's helpful. Firstly, I think it plays in the left's and also the progressive tendency to have a go at each other and start infighting and get a bit, you know, like who's a better activist than the other. But at the end of the day, we're talking about an information war. And if, you know, in order to actually promote these important narratives about Palestine and to combat the Hezbollah and the huge propaganda efforts that are used by Israel, then you, of course we need to encourage digital activism. And I think, as Kareem said, it's digital activism isn't just about going online and spreading, you know, the truth or important aspects about, you know, the occupation, but it's also about getting to the root causes of some of the systemic biases that we've seen with algorithms. You know, you need to lobby Facebook. You need to put pressure, for example, on those sponsors or the advertisers that work with Facebook. All those things are key. So when we look at activism, it isn't just about explicitly talking about, for example, Palestine itself, but it's about working at the whole infrastructure around what you know, allows certain narratives to become more salient. And I think one of the biggest and most important thing is to be to, and the sad thing is, and this really applies to a lot of US audiences where a lot of these tech companies are based, is lobbying those firms or lobbying their senators, you know, to increase transparency for these companies, you know, diminish the role of advertising and increase with better privacy laws. And crucially, to also hold them accountable for working with a state that's constantly in breach of international law. So all these things require activism. And raising the profile. And I think the sad thing is it can get frustrating. I think for people who feel removed from the struggle, it can feel frustrating just, you know, being behind a computer or even writing an email or going out into the street and protesting. But those things are always, they're so crucial in gaining that momentum. And I think solidarity is always important. It's important for morale for the whole movement. So I think anything anyone can do is essential. And let's not forget that not everyone is able to go out into the street and protest, whether it's, you know, for health reasons or other things, right? So we can't diminish the role, you know, people might, you know, be playing just because they're not, you know, on the front lines, as it were. So yeah, always solidarity and always do what you can.
Well, thank you very much, Marc, for this. I think this kind of links up with even the in my introduction, I mentioned this kind of George Orwell's notion, you know, the Ministry of Truth. And I try to expand on that and say, well, we have maybe nowadays something like the colonial Ministry of Truth. So the thing is, it's not about Palestine only. It's about, you know, all causes of justice. It's about, you know, Black Lives Matter. It's about, you know, Islamophobia. It's about every single kind of racist cause. You have some kind of colonial discourse, rather maybe discourses that dominate, you know, the media, the mainstream media. They dominate the infrastructure, Twitter, Facebook, TikTok, everything. And then they deliver certain structural kind of discourse. And this is colonialism. So when we say we want kind of to decolonize the media, to decolonize the academia, we need it to be flattened out to equality. Every voice should matter, whether it was Palestinian or non-Palestinian, but we shouldn't, I think, just get along with this kind of hierarchy of discourse, that I produce the discourse, I impose it in you, then you can live on the margins. This is the mainstream is occupied by me, the most powerful kind of maybe corporation or state or country or so on. So. Dima, we will wrap up with you. 1-2 minutes.
Khaled Taha commented in one of the questions about a campaign they're launching, which is about digital execution. He says rather than so-called legitimate censorship, and that reflects how much impact this censorship is having on a lot of Palestinian content, because entire accounts are being literally executed, as in like removed. But I want to say again, this is a fluid situation. Let's go back to 10 years ago when Arab revolts, call them whatever you want, uprising happened. The activists had full control over Twitter, for example, and it was used Facebook as well. And then electronic armies, and I think the Bahrainis were the first ones, if I remember very well, they started penetrating into the sphere that was previously controlled by and used by the activists. And now, obviously, governments use those spheres in their favor. But this is a continuously fluid situation where we can always gain ground, find new ways. Obviously, there's going to be a counter-revolution, a counter-attack. There's always going to be that. It kind of reflects what happens on the ground, you know, in any battle. So I think, yes, it is very important that we continue resisting. Yes, it is very important that we use all the instruments that we have in our hands to continue spreading our truth and to continue correcting the narrative. And I think we have seen a shift in the narrative in places like the US and Europe, thanks to the work that people do online. Big part of that achievement has to be credited to the people on who go after the New York Times and correct, you know, the terminology, who embarrass, you know, international media on their coverage on Palestine. So yes, keep doing it. It does work. It's not perfect, but it has an impact.
Okay, Dima, by this, thank you very much for this full of energy call upon all of us to remain active. And yes, there is a need to continue the same, activist track. Nothing to add, but to thank you all one by one, Helga, Marc, Dima, and Kareem for such a great event and contributions. Thank you very much one more time. And thanks for our audience. And hopefully we will see you sometime later on. This is a rich and still ongoing topic, of course. And good luck to every one of you in their own research and activism. And take care.
Thank you.